Hello and welcome to Original Sound Chat, where video game music is a work of art. On each episode, it's our goal to help you learn about two soundtracks from the world of games, as well as the people, stories, and critical tracks behind them. My name is Peter Spezia, and we're brought to you by Anonymous Dinosaur and Rhymes with Asia. It's time to appreciate great OSTs in the games that they come from without getting too bogged down in music theory. Up first this week for this solo episode is the escort mission of a boy with horns leading a girl that speaks another language as they try to escape a castle and its queen, 2001's Ico. Pretty sure Joe called that one last week with his solo episode. And he said, oh, you know, that probably means, well, Peter will have a solo episode next week. And yet that just happens to be the way things fall this week. I find myself once again in another hotel room, this time outside the Boise, Idaho area. And I'm here to talk about Ico. It turns out with the release of Resident Evil 4, the remake this week in games, Joe is going to talk about a game from that franchise. And I figured, what game could I pair with Resident Evil 4 a week? Well, with the escort mission of Ashley, the president's daughter, how about we talk about the game that is one of the most famous escort missions of all time and also has a really good soundtrack? Hardly know anything about it. It was interesting to learn, so I'm happy to share that with you today. Before we get to that, though, let's talk about some quick composer follow-up news. We've talked about many composers on this show before, and we like to follow where their work is in the game industry. What are they doing? And when it comes to game industry headlines that kind of bring those things up, the first thing we got to talk about is Persona 5 The Phantom X, which is a free-to-play RPG for iOS and Android. It's developed by Black Wings Game Studio. And they revealed this game's first gameplay in a trailer after it's been known as Codename X or P5X for the last couple of years. We have no idea how soon this game launches, or more importantly, if it will ever leave the Chinese video game market. But this trailer was riddled with Persona 5 music. Life Will Change prominently featured. Interesting to see a new Persona 5 game seemingly set in the same kind of time period. There was a shot where Taiyo Takemi was walking by. I'm like, oh, that's that doctor's lab coat with her haircut. Granted, the shot was from the back, but still, undeniably, same areas, just new characters, new shadow threats there. Should be interesting to see how that gets set up, one, on mobile, and two, with a possible free-to-play format. And is there any gacha? Is there any gacha mechanic? Nothing really reported yet, but I think there's still plenty of time left to see what will happen with Persona 5 The Phantom X, or Persona 5 X Phantom of the Night. Some weird, interesting translation differences there. Also, Coffee Talk Episode 2, Hibiscus and Butterfly, launches on April 20th for seemingly all major platforms, but yes, it is coming to Xbox Game Pass. And if you played the original Coffee Talk, you may remember our discussion about that game on Original Sound Chat episode 84. You may remember that we brought up composer Andrew Jeremy, who did the music for that game, and he seems to be working on this game as well. So he's working on episode 2. So yeah, just less than a month, and it should be exciting to see how that turns out. And go play Coffee Talk while you can. That may be something that is pushed to the forefront of my backlog. All right, for my solo episode, I get to talk about Ico in Idaho. No, that's not how you pronounce that state. I'm in Idaho, and it's Ico. No. The game is Ico, and Ico is the first game of the trilogy from what is known as Team Ico. And we've talked about a Team Ico game before, and that was Shadow of the Colossus on episode 63 of Original Sound Chat, the second of the three games. But it started with Ico, which released for PlayStation 2 in North America on September 25th, 2001. Japan got the game on December 6th, and Europe got it on March 22nd, 2002. Europe would also get a re-release of the game in 2006, alongside when Shadow of the Colossus came out in that region. Eco would be remastered in HD on PlayStation 3, known as the Eco and Shadow of the Colossus Collection, which released in September 2011. I believe that's the most recent release of the game. It's kind of surprising that, you know, of course, Shadow of the Colossus got that PS4 remake, but not Eco. Not Eco. That may be the latest place you may be able to play it. The game is developed by Japan Studio and Team Eco, and it's published by Sony Computer Entertainment. What is Eco? It is primarily a third-person 3D platform and puzzle adventure game with a mostly fixed and automatic camera. As Eco, you can do the normal elements of a platform game. You can jump, climb, push and pull objects, etc., to progress in your exploration of a castle. These actions are complicated by the fact that Eco can carry out these actions, but your companion, Yorda, can jump only short distances and cannot climb over tall barriers. And so the goal is that the player must use Eco so that he helps Yorda cross obstacles, such as by lifting her to a higher ledge or by arranging the environment to allow Yorda to cross a larger gap herself. The player can tell Yorda to follow Eco or to wait at a spot. And the player can have Eco take Yorda's hand and pull her along at a faster pace across the environment. The player is unable to progress in the game until they move Yorda to certain doors that only she can open. Eventually, shadow enemies will try to pull Yorda into a dark vortex, and Eco will have to dispel them, as he cannot be injured by the enemies. So yes, basically, this game is just a prolonged escort mission, where you can get through the puzzles in the dungeon in the castle by yourself, but you have to bring your companion, Yorda, along with you, and there are limitations to that. So what is the story of Eco? Well, Eco is a boy with two large horns protruding from his head, and he's taken by a group of warriors to an abandoned castle and locked inside a stone coffin to be sacrificed, as Eco's horns are considered a bad omen. A tremor topples the coffin, and Eco escapes. As he searches the castle, he comes across Yorda, a captive girl who speaks a different language. Eco helps Yorda escape and defends her from shadow-like creatures. The pair make their way through the castle and arrive at the bridge leading to land, but as they cross, the queen, the ruler of the castle, appears and tells Yorda that she cannot leave the castle. Basically, the big question here, what happens next, and can Eco and Yorda overcome the queen and escape the castle together? This is where I would ask Joe, Joe, what are your experiences with Eco, and what are my experiences with Eco, since Joe's not here, and it's all me, all myself, all solo. What are my experiences with Eco? I have the Eco and the Shadow of the Colossus collection in my collection, and I meant to only buy it really to play Shadow of the Colossus, and then I had a hard time with it. While I also have the Shadow of the Colossus PS4 remake, I think I got that through PS Plus. I haven't touched that yet. The idea of an escort mission has always not really been my thing with games, so while I guess in a way I do own Eco, it's never been a game I've been itching to go and play. Though when looking up, like, what do people say when it comes to, like, what are the best game soundtracks of all time? Eco is one that surprisingly pops up. And it's interesting because it's a pretty short soundtrack release, and it seems to be, you know, different moments punctuated with music. So it's not like a game that is just, you know, overridden with music, you know, something like Chrono Trigger, where music's a huge part of the experience. More that Eco has music that really supplements the experience that is told artistically without much dialogue and is meant to really emphasize the relationship between Eco and Yorda and have them go on this journey together as the music hits those moments just right. And yet, you know, listening to the music, like, yeah, especially, you know, the main track that I think people remember Eco 4, I think you can see why this music stands out, and especially at a time in 2001 where, you know, big games were really taking center stage. And yet here comes this artistic project from this team Eco that would go on to do bigger and better things. Really interesting to learn about Eco. And did it at least make me want to maybe watch a playthrough of it? Yeah. Yeah, I think it did. And I think maybe sometime might even give a shot to play it. Assuming I dig up the PS3 and hook that all up, right? But yeah, so the development of Eco was really interesting to learn about because it all started with, of course, lead designer Fumito Ueda. And Fumito Ueda, the big name behind the Team Eco experiences. And Ueda came up with this concept for Eco in 1997, envisioning a boy-meets-girl story where the two main characters would hold hands during their adventure and form a bond between them without communication. Ueda's original inspiration for Eco was a TV commercial that he saw of a woman holding the hand of a child walking through the woods. And there is also the manga series Galaxy Express 999, where a woman is a guardian for the young hero as they adventure through the galaxy, which he thought about adapting into a new idea for video games. And so the original plan in 1998 was to develop the idea and bring the game to the PlayStation, the original PS1. And Eco's design aesthetics were guided by three key notions. There was the idea to make a game that would be different from others in its genre. There was the thought to feature an aesthetic style that would be consistently artistic. And finally, to have the game play out in an imaginary yet realistic setting. And Ueda achieved this through the use of subtracting design. Basically, the idea of removing elements from the game which interfered with the game's reality. This included removing any form of interface elements, keeping the gameplay focused only on the escape from the castle, and reducing the number of types of enemies in the game to a single type of foe. Basically, if it doesn't support the main gameplay, or the story, or the emotional crux, take it away. Make it as simple as possible, subtracting design. Upon reflection, Ueda thinks that the team may have taken too much out of the game, so they didn't go to as great of an extent when it came to their next game, Shadow of the Colossus. After 2 years of development, though, the team ran into limitations on the PlayStation hardware and faced a critical choice. Either terminate the project altogether, alter their vision to fit the constraints of the hardware, or continue to explore more options. And the team decided to remain true to Ueda's vision, and they began to use the emotion engine of the PlayStation 2. Ultimately, this would cause development to last about 4 years from start to finish. The intended box art for the game that was drawn by Ueda, it was inspired by the Italian artist Giorgio De Chirico and his work The Nostalgia of the Infinite. This box art and other features would not make it in time for the planned North American release, and it created a disparity between that version and the Japanese and European versions of Eco. The most notable features, aside from some altered puzzles, include that upon completing the game, the player can restart to see the English translations of the mysterious language that Yorda uses, because in the original playthrough, there's like some hieroglyphic, boxy sort of text that is meant to be like, oh, you can't understand what she's saying. Also, there's a two-player mode in the, I guess you could say, New Game Plus version in which a second player can control Yorda, but you're still, you know, subject to those same limitations in the game. It's just not an AI controlling Yorda in this version then. So yeah, the North American version did not get those versions until actually the Eco and the Shadow of the Colossus collection. They would have to wait that long. And panicking, and as a result, they pulled together a box art for Eco that's this weird CGI form of Eco, and he's holding his sword and he's got those horns. There's a face of a girl in the background doesn't really look like Yorda at all. I don't know. It's not a great box art, and it's kind of up there as like one of the worst box arts of all time. I don't know if it's that far, but certainly vastly different than the original Ueda intended box art for Ico. Ultimately, though, when it released, Ico introduced several design and technical elements, including a story told with minimal dialogue, bloom lighting, and keyframe animation that have ultimately influenced subsequent games. It reviewed very well, with a Metacritic average of 90. It's acclaimed for its art, original gameplay, and story elements, but it's criticized for simple combat and a short duration. The game lasting about 7 to 10 hours sounds pretty good to me these days, but back in 2001, this seemed to be a common critique of, oh, the game's too short. Is it worth my money? I don't know. And it wasn't really a commercial success as a result. By 2009, only 700,000 copies of the game were sold worldwide. Maybe that North American box art did not help in that region of the world. It's certainly a critical success, though, as the game is often presented for consideration when you talk about games as an art form, especially during the discussions that were contemporary at the time. Ico was nominated for 6 Interactive Achievement Awards from the Academy of Interactive Arts and Sciences. We now know these as the DICE Awards. It was nominated for Game of the Year, and it won for Art Direction and Character or Story Development. It received 3 Game Developer's Choice Awards, including Excellence in Level Design, Excellence in Visual Arts, and Game Innovation Spotlight. It was also considered to be one of the Games of the Year by many game publications, despite competing with releases in 2001 such as Halo, Metal Gear Solid 2 Sons of Liberty, and Grand Theft Auto 3. Ico is one of the most influential games of its time. Hidetaka Miyazaki, the creator and director of the Dark Souls series, cited Ico as a key influence to him becoming involved in developing video games, stating that Ico, quote, awoke me to the possibilities of the medium. Creators like Eiji Aonuma, Hideo Kojima, Neil Druckmann, Goichi Suda, Phil Fish, Patrice Desilets, Genova Chen, and Jordan Mechner are just some of the game industry figures that note Ico as an influential title for them. Beyond that, what is the legacy of Ico? Well, Team Ico would go on to make Shadow of the Colossus in 2005, another landmark title, and then would complete their trilogy of games with The Last Guardian in 2016. No real word on what Ueda is doing next, but I'm sure he's working on something. Of course, there was the remaster of Ico on PS3 that featured 1080p graphics, stereoscopic 3D. Oh, remember when PlayStation was pushing that? I sure do. Wow. It also included PlayStation Trophy support and more. And it is also based on the European and Japanese version of the game. So, North America, thank goodness, finally got that one and its extra features. If you listened to Joe's solo episode last week with Ghost Song, you may remember him saying, oh, Peter will be talking about Michiru Oshima. And we did it. We got to a point where I planned to talk about a composer that we've already talked about before. You know, mark it down. It took this long to make it happen. Yeah, see, I already talked about Michiru Oshima. And as I was doing the research, I'm like, oh, this seems familiar. This seems too familiar. And I talked about her work on episode 132 with The Legend of Zelda Twilight Princess, because she arranged the orchestral versions on that soundtrack, the couple orchestral tracks. Not a big thing because, yeah, she composed a lot of the music in this game, but Michiru Oshima composed the music in Ico alongside a musical unit called Pentagon. And let's talk about one of the two figures from that unit. Let's talk about Koichi Yamazaki. And Koichi Yamazaki was born in Japan. That's about all of the birth info I could find. He is part of that duo Pentagon alongside Mitsukuni Murayama. And Koichi Yamazaki goes by the alias of Ram, at least as of 2013, where he released an album called Recharge, Re: Charge. He currently works for NNN Records. And you can follow Koichi Yamazaki on Twitter at RamOfficial. He's worked on some games, of course. His discography is an interesting range of sound and musical talent. So he started working on sound effects for Ark the Lad and Alundra. And then he was a sound director for Legend of Legaia. But then he did composition work, of course, on Ico. And then a whole bunch of composition work on the Beatmania games. It says, from the fourth to the final Beatmania installation. Then he did arrangement, sound design, and composition for some of the Gran Turismo games, including Gran Turismo 3 A-Spec, Gran Turismo 4, and pretty recently, Gran Turismo Sport. The score for Ico was composed, of course, by Michiru Oshima, and Pentagon, of course, comprised of Koichi Yamazaki and Mitsukuni Murayama. There is an official soundtrack release to this game, and it released on February 20th, 2002 in Japan. It's called Ico Kiri no Naka no Senritsu, which translates out to Melody in the Mist. So what does the soundtrack for Ico sound like? Well, let's talk about the five critical tracks for the game. And we have to start out with this first one. I think it's a must here. This is called Castle in the Mist. Feel like whenever you talk about what's the one song from Ico that you need to know and remember, it's this one. It's Castle in the Mist. And boy, that mandolin, the buzuki, I mean, all those stringed instruments really stand out well and give a nice mystical atmosphere to this piece. Although, judging by the fandom page for Team Ico Games, I'm trying to find, like, you know, where does this play in the game? And they say it plays in the trailer that plays while you're idle in the main menu. So maybe it was big with promotion and all that. They also talked about how maybe it also plays in the end credits. It doesn't seem to be, like, the main track that plays there, so I wonder if it's, like, on the second playthrough. Anyway, it seems to be that, you know, even playing, like, video game music trivia games or whatever, and, like, this song comes up and you have to know it's from Ico. Like, it's this one. So I feel like this is definitely a good one to put first. It's pretty early on that soundtrack. And when the soundtrack gets translated out to Melody in the Mist, and this song is Castle in the Mist, composed by Michiru Oshima. Yeah, like this is the one. Have to have it. Got to start here. Number two on the Critical Five is a song you're probably going to hear quite a lot in this game, and it has a fitting title. This is called Heal. Such a nice calming piece. I think that's like a flute kind of emulated on a synthesizer or something like that. It just sounds so nice. And this is composed by Pentagon. So Koichi Yamazaki and Mitsukuni Murayama's work here. And this is the save theme where Ico and Yorda sit on a bench to save your game and kind of create that little checkpoint in case, heaven forbid, Yorda gets sucked down a dark portal or you find yourself stuck and you gotta stop your playthrough. So yeah, just a nice little break. And it's really interesting to hear the difference between, you know, Castle in the Mist, that's iconic, and then this piece that it's a big part of gameplay. But yet, has a nice little whimsy and allows you to reflect on the relationship between these two characters so far. A simple piece, but nice, pleasant, and effective. Number three on the Critical Five, let's bring in the big antagonistic force to this game, and this is called Queen. Yamaoka? Is that you? Big, creepy Silent Hill vibes with this one. Dark synths, foreboding vibes. Just a really interesting, haunting nature to this one composed by Michiru Oshima. And this plays during the first cutscene at the main gate, also before the Queen battle. And so it just kind of represents, I guess, the character theme for the Queen, and you know, for the Queen to be the big force that stands in your way of escaping the castle and someone that may mean more to the overall story, good to have a creepy theme to go along with it. I feel like, yeah, we're still kind of transitioning out of the times of what we can do on PlayStation 1 going into PlayStation 2, but you're definitely getting an uneasy sense of what this character is all about. And definitely feeling Silent Hill with this one. Hope you do too. I hope that's not just me. But it all builds to that Queen battle. And that's with number four on the Critical Five. This track is called Entity. For this to play in the final encounter in the game against the Queen, I think this is a really interesting transposition of taking the Queen theme and kind of adding a little bit of energy to do it. And adding a little bit of energy to it to kind of make it feel like a boss battle there. And, you know, I think that it does a really good job. It doesn't have the big bombast that you would think of, a big boss encounter. I think they would certainly step that up with, you know, Team Ico's next game, Shadow of the Colossus, with its big bombast. But for the kind of game that this is, it's nice to hear the swing of, I mean, think of what we've gone through so far. We've got all the stringed instruments in Castle in the Mist. We got the really nice playful flutes in Heal, and now a creepy theme with Queen, and then twisting it up into a battle, but while still keeping those same kind of vibes with Entity. So I think a good way to kind of round out the story. It's a neat one to highlight here. Once again, composed by Michiru Oshima. But if you have a track called Ico, and it's an end credits theme, you know it's probably going to round out our Critical Five here. Not to mention there are vocals here. It kind of all comes together. Number five here on the Critical Five for Ico. This is Ico, You Were There. All right, so I take it back. If there's another song that you have to associate with Ico, it's this song, especially the melody of da 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 da, and that really just sends me back to old times of taking video game music trivia quizzes. Sporkle, Why'd you go all ad heavy, man? So, vocals on this one are by Stephen Garrity, with lyrics written by Lynn Hobday. And this is the ending cutscene, or the credits theme, also seen as the theme song for the game. And yeah, especially with that melodic line, I think like that's the big one. As far as if you have like one melodic line, and yeah, with that voice, with, you know, really nice high pitch control. Though to me, if, you know, without playing the game, I always go back to Castle in the Mist. Like, there's something about those stringed instruments that to me, I always associate with this game. But you know what? If you made it through and led Yorda all the way, then yeah, I feel like this would be a nice payoff to have this song kind of wrap up the adventure. Got a couple tracks on the cutting room floor. I have two, and the first of these is Beginning. This one's composed by Michiru Oshima, and I'll say it, this one was here for Joe. Just a nice piano piece, and we do love solo piano pieces. Again, not much to it, but if it's called Beginning, and it plays at the beginning, more specifically when you leave the altar area for the first time, it's one of those moments, and I saw a reviewer say about this game that, like, Ego's not a perfect experience, but it hits the moments perfectly. And I feel like this is one of those moments where, you know, again, punctuating the soundtrack at just the right point. And I can see how that piano piece especially would be really effective there. Pentagon composed the save theme, but they also composed this one. Another one I feel like, especially as you learn the game, you'd hear quite a lot. And this one is Continue. Once again with Pentagon, the work of Koichi Yamazaki and Mitsukuni Murayama. Interesting to compare this to the heal save theme, because if this plays on the continue theme, that means you have failed. It's a game over. Go back to your save point. And it's an interesting similarity to the save theme in that it's a little more hollow, but it kind of has like the bounciness to it. Yeah, it just rings a bit more shallow, and that, you know, there is some failure in there, but kind of, I think, the same sort of notes working with it, just a sort of, just a different tone to it. And again, if you're going to have to try to figure out how to lead Yorda through certain obstacles, and especially once the shadow enemies pop up, you might hear this one quite a bit. So pretty easy to see, but also interesting to hear how you have the same composers working on this one. So what will I never forget about Ico? I think the most interesting thing for me was learning about just how influential this game is and how many game designers really have been inspired by Ico and how it does its storytelling and how there's the subtracting design. Really neat to see. Is it really getting me up to be like, oh, I need to go play this game? No, not necessarily. I feel like none of Team Ico's games have really grabbed me in that kind of way, but, you know, might be worth watching a playthrough. It sounds like it's just a charming, emotionally evocative title, and maybe it seems up Joe's alley. I'll have to ask him the next time I get to talk to him. And that will do it for this solo episode of Original Sound Chat. You can find me on Twitter at Pete Speakeasy. Joe, my other co-host, is over at String Pixel. The video version of the show is on the Rhymes with Asia YouTube channel, but it's an MP3 podcast version that you want, and that's hosted by Anonymous Dinosaur at anondino.squarespace.com. That's where Joe's other podcast, Smasher Pieces, is hosted. And you can find Original Sound Chat and Smasher Pieces wherever you get your podcasts, on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, all the catches around the globe, including Spotify, where we have a feed of podcast episodes, but we have a Spotify playlist where if we talk about a video game music track on the show and it's on Spotify, gets added to this big, huge playlist. As far as I can tell, it looks like Eco is on Spotify. I mean, it helps when they had an official album release, and that seems like it should be a good indication that we'll get the Eco tracks added to this big Spotify playlist of video game music. When you're done listening, you can find the show on social media at SoundChatOST. Leave some feedback for us, how are we doing with these episodes, and give us some suggestions for games to cover in the future. We certainly still have some hanging around from these turned solo episodes that, the other person will have games to cover in the future. Got a whole list going there that we're making sure that we're hitting those in 2023. But yeah, let us know what you'd like us to cover for sure. Next week on the show, at least assuming that we don't have another solo episode going, Joe plans to talk about Mitsuhiro Kaneda, and I will be talking about Skrillex. I wonder what game I'm talking about there. Should be pretty easy to figure out there, I think. To play us out, we like to highlight a fan cover, a fan remix, whether it's on YouTube, OC Remix, wherever that is. And let's go to Dave Pepiat's YouTube channel. That's Dave, P-E-P-P-I-A-T-T. You know what? I came up with this list several weeks ago, many weeks ago. And I only just realized that it was only a couple weeks ago when Joe brought up Mr. Dave Pepiat and his music with a piano cover of one of the games he was talking about. So here you go. Once again, some footage of Dave Pepiat. And his piano cover is, of course, covering Castles in the Mist from Eco. So please enjoy that. Thank you so much for listening this week on Original Sound Chat. We'll see you next time. Take care.